Good evening. Today we are going to talk about liver abscess. Many of you have encountered many liver abscesses in your career. But to understand a liver abscess, whether it's pyogenic or due to amoebic, how do they present? What is the treatment modalities? It's rarely spoken, but commonly met condition. Usually common meet this condition. Somebody lying in the medical ward with high fever will be having a liver abscess. And it is routine to see the cases. But to understand what is really is going on, so that your treatment can be tailored to that individual and to give a maximum benefit, it is better we talk about liver abscess. It's a day in and day out affair in a surgeon's life. So I thought I'd talk to you about this with a little bit clarity to you. This is another specimen showing a multiple pyogenic liver abscess. Till today, except the recent papers, the pyogenic liver abscess is multiple. Predominantly on the right side, but they are multiple. But with the advent of antibiotics, with reduction in the rates of pyelonephritis, which was earlier there, it is nothing but the infection through the port wine due to an untreated complicated problem in the abdomen like appendicitis and diverticulitis and so on. Now the pyelonephritis has come down remarkably because of the early treatment modality and early with higher antibiotics. That is why the multiplicity of the pyogenic liver abscess has come down in the recent papers. But still, they will watch that multiple means it is usually a pyogenic, solitary means it is usually amoebic. We'll go ahead. We are going to talk under these topics: classification, differences between pyogenic liver abscess and amoebic liver abscess, definition, etiology, investigations, pathology, and treatment. The classification: a pyogenic liver abscess is usually polymicrobial, common being E. coli and Klebsiella. It accounts to about 80% of your liver abscess. About 10% is due to amoebic liver abscess. The incidence of the amoebic liver abscess has come down remarkably because of the earlier treatment with metronidazole and other things. Only it comes to the people who are alcoholic. Then you've got a fungal abscess, very, very rare, except in immunocompromised patients like the patients who are on chemotherapy or immunosuppressive drugs. The difference between pyogenic liver abscess and amoebic liver abscess are, usually they are multiple. Amoebic liver abscess is usually single. It can be either lobe of the liver, whereas the amoebic liver abscess is usually to the right hepatic lobe and also toward the segment 7 and 8 nearer the diaphragm. Both can present in an acute way, but comparatively, I think this is changed here. The pyogenic liver abscess presents in an acute way, whereas amoebic liver abscess present, it can present an acute or a subacute way. Jaundice is mild in a pyogenic liver abscess, except in cases where there is an increasing cholangitis due to an obstructive pathology. Otherwise, they are mild. It is moderate in amoebic liver abscess. Ultrasonogram or CT is the diagnostic tool. Plus aspiration. In CT scan, you can nicely see the cluster sign due to a lot of loculation inside the abscess, which is classical of a pyogenic liver abscess. Whereas ultrasonogram CT and amoebic serology, more than titer is more than 0.5, is in favor of amoebic liver abscess. Treatment, drainage, and antibiotics. You must start antibiotic initially without waiting for the culture sensitivity report. You should start the patient on broad-spectrum antibiotic. Subsequently, go to the specific antibiotic the moment the culture and sensitivity report comes. The thing here is metronidazole, tinidazole, and luminal amoebicidal can be given. Pyogenic liver abscess history, a dolophoid first documented the multiple abscess secondary to pyeliphlebitis following appendicitis. I have seen pyeliphlebitis following an hemorrhoid. So that is all historical. It doesn't happen now because we could understand the pathology easily. We could put the patient on higher antibiotics. We don't allow any loculation of pus anywhere so that it causes the infection into the portal vein and then takes it. This has almost become historical now. What is the definition? A space-occupying suppurative lesion resulting from invasion of the microorganism entering directly through the blood vessels. There are, the bacteremia is different from septicemia. Bacteremia is circulating bacteria in the blood without causing any symptom. If it produces toxins and produces symptoms, it becomes septicemia. A bacteremia can be normal in many other individuals. That bacteria may enter through the blood vessels. If the circumstances are there, there is immunocompression, compromise, or there is nearby inflammation. From blood vessel, there is transmigration of the microorganism, causing hematogenous infection, or through the biliary tract. The biliary tract being, if you are instrumentally manipulating the biliary tract, something like an ERCP, trying to put a stent or trying to break the stone, introducing infection, and through direct trauma. One other through the blood vessel is, could be due to pyeliphlebitis, the organism is carried through the portal vein. Males and females, 3:1, 50% solitary. Rest of the things can be multiple. Right lobe is 75%. This is due to the steaming effect of the portal vein. Because the right takes more blood quickly. Short, no long route. So steaming effect of the portal vein, predominantly supplied by the superior metallic vein, commonly contains most of the hepatic volume. So the 75% occurs in the right lobe, left lobe is 20%, caudate lobe is very rarely affected, that's about 5%. Predisposing factor, diabetes, immunodeficiency, cirrhosis, advanced age, previous biliary surgery which is causing on and off obstruction leading to cholangitis and abscess and endoscopic intervention as I've said. Pathogenesis, infections of the biliary tract is about 60% post-cholangitis. That is whenever there is a cholangitis, whenever there is an instrumentation done in a scenario which has failed, the patient will go in for cholangitis and they will go in for multiple cholangiolytic abscess. That is why a pyogenic abscess predominantly is a multiple fellow. I'm sorry, it's worrying me. 1 minute, I don't Then is portal pyemia following GI or pelvic infection, pyeliphlebitis, cryptogenic. 18% hematogenous endocarditis and pyelonephritis, or it can come in an even immunocompromised patient due to a hematogenous spread. Traumatic is 2 only. Post procedures, endoscopic sphincterotomy, biliary intric anastomosis is not draining the biliary tree properly. Post transplant due to immunosuppression, or the bile duct is not draining properly. Post transarterial chemoembolization. It is again, you are taking the infection from outside through your intervention. And chemotherapy again lyses the tissues. Then both combined gives to an abscess. Microbiology, 40% is polymicrobial, 20% is mono, and 20% the culture is negative. Because when if you knock him down with the antibiotics, the culture becomes negative in many of the cases. The commonest organism is E. coli and Klebsiella, as I've already said. In patients with endocarditis and indwelling catheters, The commonest is Staphylococcus aureus. Clinical features: fever, right upper quadrant pain, and jaundice. Only 10% will have characteristic symptoms. Any one may be there. Jaundice is a delayed complication. Anorexia and weight loss, cough and right shoulder pain due to irritation of the under surface of the diaphragm, and also due to a sympathetic pleural effusion causing impaired mobility of the lung on that side. A sympathetic effusion, or it could be due to a rupture of your abscess, which is in the subdiaphragmatic area of the liver, into the pleural cavity causing cough, or rupture into the bronchopulmonary tree and the patient can cough out all that pus, and right shoulder pain is due to irritation of the under surface of the diaphragm. Physical examination: fever, right upper quadrant tenderness. If you are very careful, if you have got a good clinical sense, then just visualize the abdomen. You can easily find out there is certain amount of edema compared to the other side. If you see the intercostal spaces on the right lateral side, there will be filling of the intercostal space with edema. Those days when the ultrasonogram was not there, our finger was the ultrasound. The maximum point of tenderness, we will put in a needle and aspirate pus. That clinical acumen is slowly gone down because of the advent of a lot of investigative modalities. So, but if you are able to see another case, you please sit down by the side of the patient. Put good light and see. There will be edema. There will be filling of the intercostal spaces, and that is due to edema. And if you carefully palpate one by one centimeter, there will be a point of tenderness. Same thing in the epigastrium due to the left lobe of the liver, you will be able to elicit a point of tenderness, except in 7 and 8 segment abscesses, which has causes at the diaphragm, which will be shown only by investigative modalities. Then hepatomegaly. In absence of cholangitis, jaundice occurs late. Cholangitis consists of jaundice, fever with rigor, elevated count, so on and so forth. That is indicative of cholangitis. Aside, is rare. Portal hypertension: if portal vein is thrombosed, you may get a portal hypertension, but that's very rare. Investigations: complete blood picture. The patient will be usually anemic because of the poor nutrition. There will be normocytic and normochromic anemia. That means there is no blood loss. It is only the patient's nutrition is not good. There is a raised WBC, especially neutrophilic leukocytosis, raised ESR, and CRP will be elevated. CRP is not pathognomonic because CRP can get elevated in any inflammatory process occurring. It is nothing but C-reactive protein. It can only be an additional thing to say, oh, something wrong is going on. Liver function test: anywhere there is a space occupying lesion, I think already I have spoken to you, anywhere there is a space occupying lesion in the liver causing pressure over the biliary radical, maybe abscess, maybe a secondary, maybe a space occupying lesion other than the secondary, immediately the obstructed biliary tree starts pouring out alkaline phosphatase from the biliary epithelium, and that gets absorbed into the circulation. So raised alkaline phosphatase must give you a high suspicion that the patient is having something wrong in the liver. With the corroborative other clinical findings and other things, you can easily find out that there is a space occupying lesion, and depends on the other clinical modality, you can even find out whether it is abscess or anything. Raised transaminases to a certain extent, bilirubin will be raised only in 10 cases when associated cholangitis or a biliary obstruction is there. Albumin level, due to the poor manufacturing because of the transfer, the cirrhotic liver, or because of the poor nutrition, there is always an hypoalbuminemia will be occurring in such patients. This is worrying me terribly. 1 minute. Okay. microbiology studies, gold standard is blood culture, and aspirated fluid culture, identified organism antibiotic susceptibility, organism is culture negative can be identified using a PCR. Initiation of antibiotics should not be delayed for want of culture. You must give a broad spectrum antibiotic. Associated metronidazole can also be given when you are in a doubt whether it's amoebic or pyogenic. That is the way to manage initially. The radiological picture is beautiful. You can see there is a right hemidiaphragm is little higher. There's a little haziness here. Could be to a minimal fluid. And if you carefully see, there is an air cavity in this. This must be one of the old cases where this could be due to a pyelophlebitis. A gas-producing organism is coming and causing a liver abscess. The prognosis is very bad. You will have to treat with multiple antibiotic therapy, letting out the pus culture sensitivity. You'll have to take care of him. Otherwise, he'll go in for a multi-organ system failure slowly. It can also happen due to iatrogenic. The iatrogenic is in the form of endoscopic sphincterotomy or putting a stent or trying to drain the bile abscess from outside can introduce air into the cavity. The screening test of choice is ultrasonogram. Guided needle aspiration, ultrasound guided needle aspiration. Abscess is usually hypoechoic with the internal septation and debris. This looks like a cluster-like appearance in the CT. There are a lot of internal septation. This is not so in a case of amoebic liver abscess. Limitation less sensitive with the microabscesses. Single lesion in the dome of the liver is very difficult because it's out of the focus of the ultrasonic probe. But you'll have to do the other modalities of investigation and get it done. See, initially, this is not completely liquefied. There are debris here. This is not liquefied. If you put in a needle, you may not aspirate much of pus. You may get aspirate pus and blood. This is not the time to aspirate it. Put this patient on antibiotic cover. Once the whole thing lies, you can see a beautiful liver abscess. The high time to take a window and put in a syringe and needle and aspirate it. If required, put a PCD here so that it will drain. Send for culture and sensitivity. Then you can start the antibiotic, subsequently change the antibiotic according to the culture sensitivity report. Investigation of choice is CT. Isolocalization of the abscess. Relation to the adjacent structure, detection of gas, which is of prognostic value. You can see how beautifully this is a pyogenic abscess. This is a hypodense lesion surrounded by a hyperdense lesion due to the take-up of vascularity, vascular supply from the neighbor, surrounded by again one more rim, that is edema. Edema near real or liver tissue taking up the contrast to a certain extent and completely hypodense. This is called the target sign, classical of a pyogenic liver abscess. You can see in a non-contrast film, it is not there. In a contrast film, it is beautifully seen. You can see the air in this. This could be iatrogenic mostly because it is found in peripherally located biliary system, usually due to a instrumentation like an ERCP. General approach, you suspect. You do an ultrasonogram and CT. You send the blood and aspirate from the abscess for culture. Blood is separate, this is separate. Send serum IgG and IgM ELISA for entamoeba scleritica. But if the patient has got acute dysentery along with that, you can elicit the entamoeba in the motion test itself. And start empirical antibiotics, adjust antibiotic as per cultural sensitivity subsequently. Treatment, drain the pus. Empirical broad spectrum parental antibiotics started immediately. Therapeutic regime revised once the culture reports obtained. Treating the underlying source of infection. Percutaneous drainage combined with the antibiotic is the first line and mainstay of the treatment. Percutaneous drainage and combined with antibiotics, usually possible on the right side. If on the left side, if it is very nearer the anterior abdominal wall, you can still do a left-sided percutaneous drainage also. Everything should be done either by an ultrasound guide or a CT guide. Joint of antibiotic, this is what we give to start with. We give piperacillin tazobactam combination, 4.5 gram IV 6 hourly. So, or we can give ceftriaxone and metronidazole. This should be followed like this, and it should be followed for 2 weeks. After 2 weeks, you have to give oral for 4 to 6 weeks to completely sterilize the abscess cavity. Diagnostic options: percutaneous needle aspirates, catheter drainage, surgical drainage. Drainage options: percutaneous needle aspiration and catheter drainage, surgical drainage, open and laparoscopic. These are the choices available. Percutaneous drainage, you can under ultrasound guided see how the pus is coming out. Absolute contraindication for a percutaneous drainage or associated biliary or intra-abdominal pathology. You don't do it until and otherwise the biliary cholangiolytic abscess is very near the abdominal wall. Coagulopathy, never do it. Do a PCR, INR. If the INR is more, don't do it. Improve the INR by giving vitamin K or fresh frozen plasma, then take the patient to surgery. If it is very proximate to the vital structures, it's better to do an open or a laparoscopic drainage. Relative contraindication: multiple abscesses cannot be drained if it is more than 2 or 3. To put a drainage catheter in all the things is very difficult. Until otherwise they are interconnected, here the choice is open. Ascites, you do not know, you do not do, because you are likely to leak the pus into the peritoneal cavity. Make a clear ascites into the peritonitis. Procedure is modified Seldinger technique, ultrasound or CT guidance, catheter inserted under guidance and secured to the skin. Catheter irrigated 2 to 3 times a day with sterile saline, provided the catheter opening is not lying outside the liver. It should be well within the liver. Otherwise, you will be soiling the peritoneal cavity. Surgery, loculated abscess, not amenable to percutaneous drainage. But my understanding about this is, if you put a big sized catheter, it will drain even if it's loculated. The loculi are likely to get dissolved and the whole abscess can be drained. Otherwise, you can do an open abscess or make that opening itself into a big, put a minimal invasive laparoscope, break out the loculi, and then it all will come. Underlying disease require primary surgical management, post-cholangitis, secondary to CBD stones. The CBD has to be drained. The best way to drain that CBD is an endoscopic probe. Do a liberal sphincterotomy at 11 o'clock position. Put a bigger size stent. Give a wash. It's likely to come down. If there is a failure of an endoscopic growth, if they are failed, then this is a case for an emergency surgery. You will have to open the CBD, take out the stone, put a bigger side, 16-side tube, so that it will drain. After some time, there is always a possibility of doing a sphincterotomy, and then pull out your T-tube at a later date. So this is a surgical emergency. Refractory to medical management for 7 days or clinical deterioration is again an indication of surgical. So what they do is, some people afraid of doing, they'll put the patient on going on antibiotic. What was a solid bit, again you'll go in for a nice necrosed area with a good abscess. At that time, if it is not getting drained, the patient will go in for an abscess which is not being drained. So at that time, you will have to go and do it. A final is rupture. A liver abscess rupture has got a very poor prognosis. The mortality is to the tune of 30 to 40% if you are not doing immediately. The thing is, put a liberal laparotomy. Don't try to go for a minimal invasive surgery in wash and all. You may not be able to do a good job until otherwise you are well versed with the minimal invasive procedure. Open, identify the ruptured site of the thing. Don't put in your finger in it. Evacuate, you're likely to get into a bleed. keep a good drain, one into the cavity, other one into the dental peritoneal cavity. Wash the peritoneal cavity nicely. Preferably suture the skin alone. Don't suture the rectus sheath, and the patient is likely to improve. Even with all this, the mortality is to the tune of 25-30% in a ruptured liver abscess. Transperitoneal route is the commonest one. Most common associated abdominal pathology can be treated. Hepatic resection, we do not do for a routine liver abscess. There is one condition where something like a choledochal cyst can occur in one of the lobes, which are fully filled with multiple hepatolithiasis, and the whole thing will become a bag of pus. That can be resected, either a left lateral segmentectomy or a left hepatectomy, where the whole thing has become a bag of pus that does not come into the regular purview of a liver abscess. This pathology is entirely different. This is due to hepatolithiasis and something like a choledochal cyst occurring in the secondary and tertiary biliary tree in one of the lobe, which is containing commonly on the left side, which is containing lot of stones, and the whole thing becomes a bag of pus so that you remove it. Otherwise, the patient will go in for recurrent attacks of cholangitis. Complications of the pyogenic liver abscess, septicemia, empyema, if it ruptures into the peritoneal, the pleural cavity, especially the liver abscess which is occurring in segments which are in the subdiaphragmatic area, that is 7 and 8, it may rupture into the pleural cavity and cause empyema. It can rupture intra-abdominally. The commonest being segment 516, 4, 2, and 3. If there are abscesses in this, they can rupture into the peritoneal cavity, causes a peritonitis. Portal hypertension is very rare. It could be due to an associated portal vein thrombosis, but they do not manifest as a portal hypertension until otherwise the patient has got an existing, pre-existing cirrhotic disease with portal hypertension. If it is a gross, big abscess with a very little parenchyma, in the background scenario of cirrhosis, the patient is likely to go in for liver failure because the functional liver tissue is less for that patient. With an associated septicemia, the patient will go under liver failure. There is one condition called endophthalmitis in 3% of the cases when the growing organism in that is Klebsiella. Amoebic liver abscess. Before that, let me address this. This is troubling me or not. Tomorrow we'll get something else. What do you say? This is troubling me a lot. Amoebic liver abscess, common in developing countries. Causative organism is Entamoeba histolytica. Mode of transmission is fecal-oral route. Mode of transmission is fecal-oral route. Life cycle. Parasite two stages, cysts and trophocytes. Cysts are infective, thrown in the motion. Orofecal route, then it becomes enlarged, then it goes to the intestine, perforates the intestine, go into the biliary radical, and gets settled in the lymph. There it produces necrosis, colligative necrosis. Liquid necrosis of the liver, that leads to amoebic liver abscess. Reaches the liver via the portal vein, mesenteric and lymphatic. Lymphatic is very limp. Commonest being the portal vein, it erodes the bowel wall, enter into the portal radical, then travels nicely. Due to the steaming effect, it commonly goes to the right side, settles down there and starts its business. More common in alcoholics, third to fourth decade, usually solitary, usually superficial, very important. Right lobe is affected 60% due to the steaming effect of the portal vein. So this is the Ankovi sauce, liquefaction necrosis, Ankovi sauce, sterile and odorless. Very important between pyogenic and this is, an amoebic liver abscess is odorless, whereas a pyogenic liver abscess is odor, because it contains lot of organisms like E. coli and Klebsiella. It can become false smelling, provided this gets infected secondarily. majority of the liver abscess after some time, due to the circulating blood, the bacteria in the blood, will get secondarily infected. Then it becomes, the color changes to creamy pus. No more it is oncovisas, and it smells. The inner wall contains the trophozoites. If you're careful, you can take a piece of inner wall scraping and send it. You can see the trophozoites of the amoeba. This is what it is. Clinical features, pain. Fever with chills and night sweats, usually when it gets secondarily infected. Weight loss, joint is very uncommon. Diarrhea present in one. I have never seen a case of an amoebic liver abscess with associated amoebic dysentery. No, I have never seen. Very rarely it could have been present before me coming to the medical institution. After me coming, I have never seen simultaneously both the cases. Probably in Western countries this can go on because those fellows are not used to an amoebic infection. I have seen many other people suffering, or many other people even went in for mortality once they step in India and get entamoeba. Because entamoeba histolytica is almost like a commensal for us. Now and then it gets activated when you take a food which is spicy or a non-veg or outside food. Otherwise, it will stay comfortably in your colon. Tenderness, anorexia, and hepatomegaly are the signs. History of travel to endemic areas. This is only for the white people. We are already the endemic. So, nothing to worry. This is only for the white fellows. I have seen white fellows suffering whenever they come to India because of amoebias. They are not used to that at all. So, of course, if it goes to the lung, it becomes empyema. There is a barrier in the liver in the right triangular ligament because the right triangular ligament is little wide, which is devoid of peritoneum here. If there is an abscess ruptures here, this can better be drained through a retroperitoneal route instead of going into the peritoneal cavity and contaminating. This is called barrier in the liver. You may not be knowing about this retroperitoneal drainage. It is one of the subdiaphragmatic abscess. You'll have to do a CT. And the CT guided, you can approach this barrier in the liver and take it. Only you should not go so deep because you will get the IVC and the right hepatic vein here. The moment you enter somewhere here in the retroperitoneum, the whole pus gushes out because on the other side, it has been locked up by the falciform ligament. So the whole thing is a contained area. A barrier in the liver abscess is one of the subdiaphragmatic abscesses, which can be drained, which has to be drained retroperitoneally. The other one is a pleura. When it enters into the lung, it becomes a bronchopulmonary fistula and it will go outside and the patient may cough out the sputum through this. That's also happened in hydatid, which is nearer the diaphragmatic surface, with ruptures into the bronchopulmonary segment. The patient will be coughing out all the grape-like thing in its in his cough. Sometimes it may be a cure and it will become all right. Then if it occurs on the skin, amoebiasis cutis, deadly, 100% mortality, very difficult to treat, but not seen in India, but seen in whites. Caucasians are very much suffering amoebiasis cutis because they don't have immunity. The other one is it can enter into the portal system, it can enter into the pericardium and causing a pericardial tamponade. I have drained two pericardial tamponade to the ruptured liver into the pericardium. The other one is barrier, everything I said, I did it. Okay, finished. I can go on talking about it because this is routine for me. Laboratory investigation, LFT is normal. Prothrombin time is elevated because the manufacturing capacity of the liver has come down. You will have to give injection vitamin K. If the manufacturing capacity of the liver is still intact, the prothrombin time will come down and you will get a good INR. If it is not so, you will have to give a fresh frozen plasma which contains this and the patient will become INR wise normal so that you can go on intervene. Leukocytosis if secondarily infected, very important. Oh, liver abscess, no infection, it must be mostly amoebic or the patient is immunocompromised or is a severe diabetic. All these conditions, leukocytosis will not be there. Stool examination, you can find sustained trophozoites, 15 to 50%. Serology, indirect hemoglobin assay, gel diffusion precipitate, detection of IgG antibodies, positive dilution exceeds 1:128. Aspiration to differentiate from pyogenic liver abscess when serology is negative, you will have to put a needle and aspirate, and that's a contraindication in the malignant hydatid. So this picture has got no relevancy here, that's a different picture. Diagnostic aspiration to differentiate from pyogenic liver abscess when the serology is negative, you are confused whether it's amoebic or a pyogenic liver abscess, you have to do a diagnostic aspiration. It's only contraindication in malignancy and hydatid. Hydatid may rupture and the fluid can cause an anaphylactic shock. If malignancy, you will disseminate the malignancy, which will become stage 4. Here, we are trying to show you that the colonoscopic appearance of an amoebic liver abscess is a flask-shaped ulcer. Nowadays, you cannot see. Those days, we used to see. It's a flask-shaped ulcer, sigmoidoscopic, narrow neck, then the base. It's called flask-shaped. This is only to show you this theory has got no relevance with this. This is what we wanted before. Imaging modality of choice, ultrasonogram, note peripheral location, it is peripherally located, round shape, poor rim with internal echoes. This is classical of an amoebic liver abscess, CT scan. There you could get a nice hyperemic cover. Here, because there is no inflammation, you are not getting an hyperemic cover. There is hypodensity followed by edema. That's all. This is again a liver abscess, again with a lot of pleural reaction, raised right dome of the diaphragm, pleural effusion, everything is there. So you have to do an MRI or nuclear scan, but I don't do it at all. With a CT alone, with my clinical acumen, I can make a 100% diagnosis of a liver abscess. An 100% diagnosis whether it's a pyogenic or amoebic. These two are not very important. Antibiotic is the first line of treatment. Metronidazole 750 mg TID in 10 days. Emetin, you have to be very careful because it produces severe cardiotoxicity. It should be under the observation of an intensivist or the cardiologist. We have stopped emetin. My boss asked me to give dihydroemetin and another patient was suffering. While we were doing rounds, I loaded and given. Within 5 minutes, he passed away. It was no more. So don't do it. Chloroquine is a nucleotide poisoning. Yes, very much. It's a nucleotide poisoning, which has got an effect to kill the amoeba so that we can add chloroquine. The chloroquine should be, you know, the days, the dose, nothing very much to worry except the neurotoxicity, but that is not happening at all. The other one is optic nerve injury, correct? Chloroquine, but I have not come across one. This emitting, never ever do it. I had a very bad experience when I was a postgraduate. Patient died in the bed. Don't do that. Luminal amoebicides for eradication of asymptomatic colonization. Diloxinate, 4-8, paramomycin, iodoquinol, all there are so many things. Let me tell you, my dear children, you can never eradicate amoebiasis from an Indian. They are so friendlier. They will be dormant for some time. When the things are favorable for it, it will show its original color. Some bloated feeling, lower abdominal pain, colicky pain, colonic tenderness all over. These are classical. It is a friend of Indian. Sometimes it shows its irritability to us. I have never seen a case where you can completely eradicate amoebiasis. Have you ever seen? Impossible. Therapeutic aspiration, more than 5 cm left lobe abscess provided there is no intervening tissue under ultrasound guided. Symptomatic death rate of 3 days treatment when the contraindication for anti-amoebic treated by metronidazole, especially in pregnancy. Majority of the amoebic infections, amoebic liver abscess, but small. You can put the patient on anti-amoebic treatment. Prevent a secondary infection by giving a good antibiotic. You don't aspirate it at all. Sometimes it resolves by itself. Until there is a bigger one, nearer the thing, patient is not improving. Contraindication for medical therapy, you do this. surgical strain identification, left lobe abscess not amenable to perfusion, life-threatening hemorrhage, I am yet to see. Septicemia from secondary wound, oh yes, you will have to do it. Erosion into neighboring tissues, yes, of course, I have not seen one. Conservative treatment failure, mostly by conservative treatment, they will become moderate. Management of the ruptured liver is one of the deadliest conditions. I told you, you must give a liberal laparotomy, open up, mobilize the liver if it is a non-approachable area of the liver, the abscess, evacuate the content slowly without causing much bleed, keep a drain there, keep a drain into the peritoneal cavity, wash the abdominal cavity, peritoneal cavity, about 5 liters of warm saline, try to suture the skin alone, don't hesitate, leave the rectus. If the patient becomes all right within your postoperative period, you can always take the patient back to the theater. Give us final anesthesia, open the skin and close the rectus. That is once for all done. Why? Because I am asking you not to close the rectus. You may have to give repeated wash in such patients. Either it is due to pyogenic liver abscess or amoebic liver abscess. You may require a physical wash. Physical wash is an important thing. Because it's physical removal of the infection. Physical removal of the infection is 100 times better than treating with antibiotics. This is many of the surgeons' experience. Keep it in your mind. That's all, no? We have spoken everything. No? Delay side mortality, that's all. Any other abscess is left over, you can just palpate and see it will be found. Otherwise, you put an intraoperative ultrasound, that drain and that also. See, this is laparoscopy. I am not in favor of it because I am not used to it. But if some people are used to it, they can do it with a comparative clearance like an open surgery. You have to put a small incision in the liver, suck out the whole thing before it soils the peritoneal cavity, and suck out all the pus which has already been drained into the peritoneal cavity, give a thorough wash, keep multiple drains and come out. The patient is not improving. Again, you take him to the theater and give a wash. A multiple wash instead of opening, you can keep through the laparoscopy itself. I am not familiar with this. I am only an open surgeon. So, but the results are same and good, provided a good minimally invasive surgeon does it. Summary. If untreated, the mortality is 100%. Let me tell you, my dear people, 100% mortality. The present mortality is anywhere between 15 to 20. Investigation, LFT, ultrasonogram, and CT. Serology is the cornerstone to differentiate. PLA, antibiotic and drainage, causative pathology should also be treated. Amoebic liver abscess, amoebicidal agent followed by luminal agent, drain only for complicated cases. Underline, there is no drainage here. The complication being rupture, the complication being secondarily infected, the complication being it gets eroded into a blood vessel and causing hemorrhage. I have never seen, but the first two complications I have seen. Otherwise, if it is only an amoebic liver cell, you are cocksure about it, leave it, it will get absorbed. When there is a high index of suspicion, treatment should not be withheld until the diagnosis is confirmed. That depends on your investigative modality findings, your clinical suspicion, general well-being of the patient, performance status, organ functioning, everything put together, you could come to a conclusion whether it should be intervened or not. Thank you.